Welcome, everybody, to the library tonight. My name's Jerry Carboni, I'm the library director, and I'm very happy to see you here. Tonight, we have Dr. John Stauffer of Harvard, who will speak on the two giants, to steal a phrase from his book of 19th century America, Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. Before the talk can begin, I'd like to acknowledge the Vermont Humanities Council. They are the main sponsor for First Wednesdays. And tonight, in eight other locations across the state, people like you are listening to a talk. Tomorrow, I'll be meeting with Allie White, the coordinator of First Wednesdays, and we'll be planning next year's program. So we have a yellow feedback form on the table there, so if you wouldn't mind filling it out before you leave and perhaps putting some suggestions of topics you'd like to hear next year. We also like to thank our local sponsors for this series, Bradboro Savings and Loan and Don's Racklin Martin, for their continuing their multi-year financial support for the series. And this year we've got two new sponsors, Vermont Country Store and New Chapter, Inc. I'd also like to acknowledge the Vermont Department of Libraries for being a statewide sponsor for the series. Of course, none of this would be possible except for the support of the Friends of the Library. And if you don't know, the Friends provide advocacy and financial support for our programs and other services the library offers. If you're not a member of the Friends, I encourage you to join. We have a membership form at the table at the back. Everyone's books will be selling Dr. Stauffer's book tonight, and he'll be signing after the program, so please help yourself to those titles as well. I'd like to thank Maria Dominguez, who is the volunteer videographer for BCTV. This program will come back to us as a DVD for you to check out, where you will be able to watch it on the broadcast, or you can stream it from your computer. I usually, in my e-news, put a link back to the programs that the library sponsors here, so you just watch out for my e-news and you'll see that link. If you'd like to tell your friends, you can forward that to them as well. Next month, April 3rd, we'll have a talk by Amherst art professor Carol Clark, who will discuss the impact of great American artists such as O'Keeffe, Bierstadt, Edward Hopper, and Caitlin that have had on the ideas of the American West. So that'll be at 7 p.m. Wednesday, April 3rd. So it's my distinct pleasure tonight to introduce John Stauffer. He's the chair of History of American Civilization Program and a professor of English and African-American Studies at Harvard. He is the author or editor of eight books and more than 50 articles on subjects ranging from anti-slavery, race relations, and the Civil War to photography, biography, and the importance of the humanities in the 21st century. His books include The Black Hearts of Men, a collective biography of black and white abolitionists who forged intimate bonds of friendship and alliance. It won four major awards. And Giants, The Parallel Lives of Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, which was published in 2008, which won him the Iowa Author Award and the Boston Authors Club Award. His essays have appeared in Time Magazine, The Wall Street Journal, New York Times, Washington Post, Huffington Post, and The New Republic, and other publications. He has appeared on national radio and television shows, including Diane Rehm Show and Book TV with Susan Swaim, and he has lectured widely throughout the U.S. and Europe. His expertise and commentary were used during the acclaimed PBS series, The Abolitionists, that was on local and national stations just this past January. So please join me in welcoming Dr. John Stauffer.
Thank you, Jerry. That was a very generous introduction. Can everyone hear me in the back? So if my voice trails off for some reason, raise your hand and I'll speak up. I want to talk for about 50 minutes tonight, and then I'll open it up for question and answers. And I'd like to begin by giving you a brief introduction of how I became interested in Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, and then summarize or give you some of the central themes about how and why Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln led parallel lives, how and why they became friends, and then give you a few images to show you what Douglass and Lincoln were up against, and highlighting the power of race, really, in the United States. And then end with the legacies, why I think they remain important and extremely influential today. Let me just begin by asking how many of you in this room have not read anything by Abraham Lincoln? Hands high, two or three people. How many of you in this room have not read anything by Frederick Douglass? Hands high. A lot more. In my view, if every American were required to read Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, this nation would be a better place. I think, among other things, they're the two of the greatest nonfiction writers in American history. My interest in Douglass and Lincoln really began when I was a teenager. I grew up in Iowa, Nebraska, North Dakota. One of the central experiences of my upbringing was that we moved from back and forth between those three states. In K through 12th grade, I was in 8 different schools, so I was essentially an outsider a lot. And I had the great fortune, not in a classroom, but when I was 13 years old, a friend of mine, Freddie Davis, gave me the narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass, the first of his 3 autobiographies, describing how he struggled against slavery. He's born a slave, prohibited from reading and writing, and how he was able to define himself as a human and escape slavery and begin his career as an abolitionist lecturer. And it was a period in my life, partly I think because of all the moves, in which I was really yearning for that kind of a narrative, which is part of the heroic generation in which Frederick Douglass, Abraham Lincoln, the people of the Civil War believed that individuals could make a difference in the world. They believed that individuals could change society and could transform themselves. And I needed something like that. And even though I really didn't understand race, although I was in public schools and interacted with a number of African Americans and in Fargo Native Americans, Douglass spoke to me profoundly. I wanted to be like Frederick Douglass in an ironic way. And that led me to other figures in the Civil War. I started reading Lincoln and fell in love with Lincoln, and then Whitman and Emily Dickinson, and that started this long-standing interest in the Civil War era. There's a professional reason as well. When I entered graduate school at Yale, I became very interested in interracial friendship because I see friendship in general as a symbol of democracy. The Greeks, Plato, Cicero, Aristotle, among others, very self-consciously said that a virtuous republican society is one in which friendship flourished. And the founding fathers did the same. In fact, the Articles of Confederation defined the various states as friends. But interracial friendship, or for that matter intersexual male-female friendship, has always been a problem. Friendship throughout Western culture had been defined as liking another person and being like a person. Thus, black, white, master, slave, rich, poor, man, woman could not be friends. And that was something that early Americans grappled with because they understood that their society was a multiracial society. The first book led to this, Black Hearts and Men, 2 black and 2 white abolitionists. Douglass is one of them. John Brown is another, who forged these bonds of friendship and alliance that were unprecedented in the 19th century based on this really rich collection of biracial correspondence. And while I was ensconced in the research, I realized that, or came to find out, that Frederick Douglass was the first black man to meet with and advise a U.S. president on terms of equality, Lincoln. He met with Lincoln 3 times. They considered themselves friends. And at that point, no one had really written more than about 5 to 7 pages on that. And in 2005, I was asked, when Lincoln was featured on the cover of Time magazine, I was asked to write an essay on Douglass and Lincoln's relationship. And I actually fell in love doing the more research on that, and that led to the book. So hence that background. The central theme of this book and my understanding of the relationship between Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln is that they're the two preeminent self-made men in American history. And they led strikingly, surprisingly parallel lives that ultimately converged into friendship. Long before they ever met, they were very similar in ironic ways. Frederick Douglass, who is born a slave on the eastern shore of Maryland, prohibited from reading and writing, as I said, rises up to become the most famous black man in the Western world before the age of 40. In fact, for most of his career, from 1846, when he publishes his first autobiography, The Narrow the Life of Frederick Douglass, it's a huge bestseller. In fact, it's such a big bestseller that Frederick Douglass becomes virtually a household name in the United States. Frederick Douglass became better known, was better known than Abraham Lincoln until 1860. Frederick Douglass was considered in his day a far better orator and writer than Abraham Lincoln. And you all know that Abraham Lincoln was born in a log cabin. But you probably don't know that, similar to Frederick Douglass, he had less than 1 year of formal education. He was called poor white trash when he was a young kid. Born on a farm, his father was a farmer, virtually illiterate. And Lincoln rises up to become, in my view, the nation's greatest president. So hence the self-made men. Douglass and Lincoln, so then the question is, well, how and why were they able to rise up in the way they did? And the central theme that is one of the three main parallels I'll talk about is that long before they ever met, in this one a slave, one a poor white trash, they understood the importance of using words as weapons. They understood the importance of language. Because if you're a young boy, and especially a boy at this time because of the gender discrimination, if you could use words as weapons, if you could become an effective orator, there are few limits. This was an age in which public speaking was one of the very few forms of entertainment. In fact, people would travel for hundreds of miles to hear a great orator. Those of you are probably familiar with this, the Lincoln-Stephen Douglas debates in Illinois of 1850. Farmers throughout the Midwest would go watch a debate for their vacation. In a sense, it was a bit like being a professional athlete or a rock star or a movie star today. And Douglas and Lincoln understood this. And long before they ever met, they virtually memorized, cut their eye teeth on the same 6 books or authors. Anyone want to guess what they were?
The
Bible, very good. That's the King James Bible, and I don't care what your religion is, but if you read the King James Bible and you read it closely, you can't help but become an effective writer and orator. It's one of the great works of literature in world history. What else?
Shakespeare.
Some of you read the book. The difference between Shakespeare in their day and Shakespeare now is we read Shakespeare because we're given it to us in school. At this time, everyone read Shakespeare. Men, women, rich, poor. I've come across some dirt farmers in Mississippi where I did some other research. They have 5 books in their shack and one is Shakespeare. And they could quote Shakespeare at length. What's another one? What's this? No, not Pilgrim. That's a great guess, but it's not Pilgrim's Progress. What else? No, not Socrates. If Shakespeare was considered the greatest writer of English, the second one was Lord Byron. He's not as well known anymore. But Americans, actually, there's still a book or essay waiting to be written on the cult of Byron in the United States. Americans absolutely adored Byron, probably more than the British, because they saw him as a great freedom fighter in his life and in his poetry. He dies fighting for the cause of freedom in Greece. And Byron's Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, which was just this runaway bestseller. In fact, Byron said famously that he woke up overnight famous because of Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. And it describes this self-made man through epic poetry. Douglass and Lincoln could quote long swaths of Lord Byron. And the other is Robert Burns, the poor Scottish farmer, who turns his accent or dialect into an art form. And especially Lincoln, who's also a farmer, according to many of his friends, had memorized every single one of Burns's poetry. The fifth is Aesop's Fables. You're all familiar with Aesop's Fables. What you probably don't know about it is that Aesop's Fables, the best way to summarize it is that it's a collective slave narrative. Aesop's Fables are stories from slaves in classical antiquity, particularly Roman Italy, describing of their vicious world and how to survive in it. And when Douglas and Lincoln read it, it was before the morals at the end. And the sixth was Columbian Order, which was a collection of speeches designed for young boys like Douglas and Lincoln to teach them to become effective orators. And it was edited by one of the great 19th century educators, Caleb Bingham. And in his introduction, he's speaking, and he describes the importance of becoming a democratic order, not an aristocratic order, and not a yahoo, not a poor white trash order. And he describes how it's important when you're practicing your speaking to take a little pebble, he's borrowing from Demosthenes, put it under your tongue so you understand, you know the exact location of your tongue, and so you can enunciate properly and overcome your accent. And this was crucially important to Douglas and Lincoln. Lincoln pronounced his name as a young boy as Linkhorn. I mean, his dialects, first of all, were far more pronounced, far more severe then than they are now. And to be a democratic orator, you had to lose some of that accent. And in the book, I give a sense of what Douglas would have sounded as a young boy, and it wasn't pretty. And Douglas was more effective at losing that accent. Their number of, especially Yale, Harvard, college-educated men who would meet Lincoln at the White House, and they'd come away saying that he sounded like a yahoo, even though what he said was actually quite intelligent and very thoughtful. Those six books, along with others, were absolutely crucial. A second parallel, and it's ironic, is that is the very moment in which Douglas and Lincoln are defining themselves as aspiring or budding intellectuals, even though one's poor white trash, one's still a slave. They both enter into a fight that they consider the turning point in their lives. For Frederick Douglass, now Douglass learns how to read and write fortuitously. He's sent to Baltimore as a young boy, as an 8-year-old boy, to be the playmate of a white boy. And his mistress, Sophia Auld, he had never owned a slave before, never managed a slave before. And she inadvertently taught Douglass his ABCs. And she heard her husband, Hugh Auld, say, you cannot do that. The easiest way to unfit a slave for slavery is to teach him to read. And Douglas heard that and said, well, if that's the case, I'm going to learn how to read. And he traded, literally, to describe this, he traded cookies for words with white boys in the streets of Baltimore. He practiced his handwriting with chalk in Fells Point in Baltimore. And after spending a few years there, he's literate, he's learned how to read and write. He is sent back to the eastern shore of Maryland, and his master there, Thomas Auld, felt that he was an inappropriate slave, because with literacy comes a sense of confidence, comes a sense of dignity as a human. So he stared his master in the face, he would talk back to him, and Thomas Auld said, this is totally unacceptable for a slave. And he rents Douglas out for a year to a man named Edward Covey, who was famous in the eastern shore of Maryland as being a slave breaker, because he wanted to break Douglas's will. For the first 6 months being under the employ of Covey, Douglas said that he was brutally whipped at least once a week. The welts on his back were as thick as his thumb. They hadn't yet healed, and he received another whipping for what? No reason really whatsoever. It was an attempt to break him. And Douglas said that after 6 months, he was brutalized. He said he felt like an ox or cattle. And he decided to stand up to Covey. Douglas was very big. He's 6'2". He's very burly. Covey was, the average height of men was about 5'6". Then Covey's about 5'6", wiry. They had this 2-hour epic battle. Douglas probably could have killed Covey, seriously maimed him. But he knows that if he does, he's going to probably be killed or sent into Mississippi. Instead, he just primarily defends himself, and after 2 hours, Covey gives up. And Douglas said, throughout the rest of his life. He says, this fight with Edward Covey was the turning point in my life. From that moment forward, he said, he defined himself as a free man in form, even if he remained a slave in fact. And really, from that moment, his life's mission was clarified. He would devote his energies to becoming free himself and champion freedom for everyone and seeking racial equality. And it was, he describes that fight as absolutely central to his eventual escape and his career. Lincoln had a similar fight when he was, now Lincoln's father, it was barely literate. Lincoln's father, we know, beat Lincoln when he found him reading because he considered reading laziness. He should be working on the farm, manual labor. And Lincoln also described his early life as being a slave because legally he had to turn over every penny he earned to his father. He didn't get along with his father. As soon as he turned 21, he leaves. He moves to New Salem, Illinois to start in his life. He's, like Douglas, very ambitious. And in New Salem, which is this raw kind of frontier town, one of the myths of Lincoln's upbringing is the description of these communities as bucolic and idyllic. This is this brutal, raw frontier town. And the local leader, a man by the name of Jack Armstrong, he was known as luring, he and his buddies would lure people into poker games, steal their money, beat them up, and send them on their way. Armstrong loved, if public speaking is one of the great forms of entertainment, fighting was another one. And Armstrong challenged Lincoln to a no-holds-barred rough and tumble. He felt threatened by Lincoln because if Douglas is big and strong, Lincoln is 6'4" and his bare feet, as he'd like to say. And Armstrong felt threatened, and he challenged Lincoln to a no-holds-barred rough and tumble. It was a kind of fight in which it was not uncommon for a man to lose part of his ear, part of a finger, part of a nose, and the great prize in these fights was to liberate an opponent's eyeball and keep it as a trophy. And there were indeed some men in New Salem who were missing an eye. And Lincoln didn't like fight and said, I'm not going to fight you in a no-holds-barred rough and tumble. I'll agree to a regulated wrestling match. Said, okay. It's unclear exactly what happened because of the haze of memory and all the people gathering around betting on the fight, but what best we know is that Armstrong fouled Lincoln. Lincoln calls it a foul. No one loses money, and at the end of the fight, they become friends. And that fight, Lincoln acknowledges, was a turning point because it really begins Lincoln's career as a leader in his community. Within 6 months, he's in fact elected captain of his company in the Black Hawk War, and within roughly a year after that, he begins his long tenure career in politics, beginning with the Illinois State Legislature. And the third parallel is that for both men, the women in their lives are absolutely instrumental in their success. For Frederick Douglass, Anna Murray, first of all, they marry up, both marry up. Anna Murray is a free black woman, never been a slave. He meets her in Baltimore. It's her money, she works as a domestic, it's her money that allows him to buy a train ticket that he uses to go to New York City. It's her money that allows him to acquire a sailor's uniform so that he can pass as a free black sailor. And it's her money that allows him to acquire the equivalent of a passport that he can show the conductor on the train to go to New York City and to freedom. And once he arrives, she comes, they marry. And really, she works as a domestic when he begins his career as a public lecturer for the American Anti-Slavery Society because he wasn't making enough money. And Mary Todd Lincoln is usually still dismissed by, I would say, many if not most scholars as a kind of mad woman in the attic. And yet Mary Todd was more savvy about politics when she met Lincoln than Lincoln. Lincoln's hero was Henry Clay, the founder of the Whig Party. Lincoln loved Henry Clay. Mary Todd Lincoln grew up next to Henry Clay's estate in Kentucky. She sat on Clay's knee when she was a little girl. She understood Whig politics better than Lincoln. In fact, they started dating around their shared passion for Whig politics in the 1840 political convention. Stephen Douglas, Lincoln's nemesis, tried to court Mary Todd, but she refused to date a Democrat. And Mary Todd advised Lincoln in every step of the way until he reached the White House. Now, before Douglas and Lincoln met, it's once they knew of each other, and we know that Douglas first mentions Abraham Lincoln in his newspaper when Lincoln is the congressman in the House from Illinois, and Douglas responds to Lincoln's House Divided speech, which launches his Senate campaign against Stephen Douglas, and loves that address. But Douglas and Lincoln were fundamentally different politically. As I've suggested, Douglas's politics was that he was a prudent revolutionary. That's the best summary. His entire adult life, he advocated an immediate end to slavery and racial equality. And that, in the United States, was truly revolutionary. And Lincoln, you can see Lincoln as representative of most Northerners. When Lincoln was elected president, most Northerners were anti-slavery. And that's very different from being an abolitionist, as Douglas was. Lincoln said he hated slavery as much as any abolitionist, but that doesn't mean that you're an abolitionist. I can say I hate pollution and chain smoke and throw litter around. Doesn't mean I'm an environmentalist. Lincoln's solution to slavery was three-pronged. One should be very gradual abolition over a long period of time, so as not to uproot society. He's not a revolutionary. He's horrified of revolution. In fact, in his debates with Stephen Douglas, when pressed on when he believed the ultimate extinction of slavery would occur, he said, not less than 100 years. I'd put the end of slavery in 1958 at the earliest. From Douglas's perspective, that's not acceptable. Secondly, he called for compensating masters for the loss of their property, also from Douglas's perspective, isn't being really sympathetic to the plight of the slave. And third, most egregiously, Lincoln, like most other white anti-slavery Northerners, championed colonization. In other words, in freeing blacks over a long period of time, you deport them, you colonize them, you do it voluntarily, but you really encourage them to leave the country. In essence, Lincoln, like most other white anti-slavery Northerners, believed that democracy was a white man's democracy. That was how Lincoln's vision at the beginning of the Civil War. And in fact, Douglas considered Lincoln, before they met, his worst enemy when Lincoln gave his inaugural address in 1861. Why is that? Because, first of all, when Lincoln gave his inaugural address, you probably know this, it's seven states have already seceded, Confederacy has already been formed. Lincoln's chief aim, he's basically trying to lure these seceded states back into the Union. He thought they were bluffing. Prevent the Upper South from seceding. So he's conciliating to these southern states. So are most other Republicans. And he says two things in his inaugural address that makes Frederick Douglass plan to leave the country for good. And those two things are Lincoln vows to enforce more rigorously the fugitive slave law, which Frederick Douglass, even some Republicans like William Seward and Charles Sumner, considered unconstitutional because it suspended habeas corpus. And Lincoln in his inaugural address vows to give it more teeth. And second, and most onerously, 2 days before Lincoln gives his inaugural address on March 6th, Congress, the Republican Congress, was in their effort to conciliate with the South, had just passed a new constitutional amendment. Now, if you've seen the Lincoln film, you know the 13th Amendment is the amendment that abolishes slavery. The first 13th Amendment is what Congress had passed 2 days before Lincoln's inaugural address in 1861. And it is an unamendable amendment, that's the language in it, that guarantees slavery in the slave states forever. And Lincoln in his inaugural address says, I support it. Frederick Douglass reads it and says, I'm out of here. He plans a trip to Haiti. Because he says, with this, he had been hopeful, he said, with this man as president, there's no way that this nation will ever fulfill its ideals of freedom and equality. And Haiti was known as the West's first black republic. He doesn't go to Haiti because Southerners bombed Fort Sumter, and Douglas understands that with Civil War, this is a golden opportunity to end slavery. And from the time of Fort Sumter until his first meeting with Lincoln, until the Emancipation Proclamation, rather, Douglas understood that the easiest way to win the war and to preserve the Union was to emancipate slaves. He said in all of his speeches and his newspapers that he sent to the White House that 4 million blacks in the South constitute a potent source of black power. If you don't emancipate slaves, they're going to be doing the dirty work for the Confederacy. Confederates are going to use them to build roads, build forts, build arms, which they did. If you emancipate them, they will make every effort to free the Union lines because they'll know they'll be safe there. And Lincoln and the Lincoln administration refused to emancipate slaves until late in 1862 for a number of reasons, principally because Lincoln especially was deeply concerned about the border slave states, Maryland, Kentucky in particular, because if Maryland secedes, Washington, D.C. is surrounded, and that's the end of the war, essentially. And Douglas said that the border states are a millstone around your neck. Finally, Lincoln was actually tardier than the rest of Congress. Congress passed the first Confiscation Act that confiscates slaves, which in practice means they're free, even though they don't legally free them. Then the second Confiscation Act frees all slaves who reach Union lines in mid-62 and calls on the president to issue a proclamation to give it teeth. And when Lincoln issues his Emancipation Proclamation, Douglas's true hatred of Lincoln irrevocably and dramatically changes, because Douglas understands that with this proclamation, the war is now a moral war. It is a fight between civilization and barbarism. And the PL also understands, as everyone else does, that the Emancipation Proclamation also calls for the arming of blacks as soldiers. And that's especially important for blacks because at this time, the notion of citizenship was very vague and unclear. But one thing that just about every American understood, and that is if you fight for the federal government, if you're in the Army or Navy with the federal government, that means you're a citizen. And with the Emancipation Proclamation, the first black regiment in the North, the Massachusetts 54th, is founded. Douglas devotes full time to recruiting black soldiers. His two sons are among the first two recruits. And by July of 1863, he is again frustrated because black soldiers are only being paid half of what white soldiers are, and they're not being promoted. So Douglas decides to take his case to Washington, D.C. Go to see the president even though he doesn't have an appointment. He arrives in D.C. at early in the morning of August 10th. He goes to the White House. I'm simplifying the story. There's already in the morning a long line of whites waiting to see Lincoln. Douglas sends up his card, thinks he's going to have to wait all day, maybe two. And within 2 minutes, Lincoln has called Douglas up to his office. And as he climbs the steps to Lincoln's office, he hears one white man mumble, "I see how it is, they let the nigger through." And when Douglas enters the office, Lincoln says, "Hello, Mr. Douglas, it's very nice to meet you. I know you, I've been reading you, I know you've been very critical of me." And Lincoln spends the first half hour defending his policy, defending his tardiness, and emphasizing to Douglas, once I might be tardy, I might be slow, but once I make a decision, I'm not going to turn back on it. They have an hour meeting. Lincoln promised eventually to pay black soldiers what white soldiers were being paid, and emphasized to Douglas, "You got to see, understand my perspective. You understand the racism. I've been telling black men to go kill and shoot whites and giving them guns to do so. For a lot of people, that's not pretty." At the end of this hour meeting, the next person that Lincoln saw that day in the White House is a man named John Eaton. And Lincoln, we know this from Eaton's writings, Lincoln says to Eaton, "I said, I just had a meeting with Frederick Douglass, who I consider one of, if not the most meritorious men in these United States." You can't ask for higher praise than that. Douglass gave a speech later that day and said, "I just had a meeting with the president. I consider him the king of self-made men." That was one of the highest forms of praise also at that time. Their second meeting occurred a year later in August of 1864, and this meeting really highlights the social revolution that had occurred. This is a meeting in which Lincoln sends a telegraph to Douglass's home in Rochester saying, "I need you. Please come to Washington." Lincoln was certain he was going to lose re-election. It's mid-64. The casualties, the deaths have been just astronomical, far greater than anyone had ever expected. And Northerners wanted the war over. And the Democratic candidate, George McClellan, was campaigning on a platform of let's have immediate peace and negotiated settlement, which would almost certainly have left slavery intact and probably allowed the Confederacy to remain a separate country. So Lincoln says, "I need you in the White House. This is an all-expense-paid trip. There's a presidential carriage waiting to pick Douglass up at the railroad station." And when Lincoln sees Douglass, he says, "Mr. Douglass, I think I'm going to lose the election. What I'd like you to do is to embark upon a John Brown scheme in which you take some hand-picked men and you invade the South and you bring back as many blacks into Union lines as possible. Best case scenario, thousands of blacks will be brought into Union lines. They'll form regiments. It'll help us achieve a major military victory, turn the tide of public opinion in the North, and help me get reelected." And now Lincoln's central platform for reelection is the 13th Amendment that does end slavery. Worst case scenario, Lincoln says, "I lose. The Confederacy wins the war, but thousands more blacks will have been brought into Union lines." And Douglass said, "I never understood the degree to which Lincoln hated slavery as at that moment." Now, Douglass considered John Brown, who many Americans today see as the first homegrown terrorist because he raids Harper's Ferry, Douglass considered John Brown one of his closest friends. And after Brown raids Harper's Ferry as one of the last sparks leading to the Civil War, Douglass called Brown for the rest of his life the greatest man in the 19th century. Brown lived with blacks. Said when he first met Frederick Douglass, Douglass said that Brown is the only white man he'd ever met who was in sympathy, essentially a black man, because he hated slavery as though his very soul had been pierced with it. And now Lincoln is telling him to embark upon a John Brown scheme. That was truly extraordinary. Douglass ends up not organizing this these handpicked men, although he does send Lincoln about a 15-page outline. Essentially, it's the precursor to the special forces, because Sherman takes Atlanta, turns the tide of war, and helps Lincoln get reelected. Their last meeting is in the second inaugural. Douglass attends the second inaugural. He has essentially a front row seat. At this inaugural, it's, according to most newspaper accounts at the time, majority of people in the inaugural were African Americans. He's invited to the White House for the reception afterwards. When he first tries to get in the White House, a policeman turns him away, said no blacks are allowed to enter. Douglass said there must be some mistake. He ends up allowed in. And he sees Lincoln in the East Room, and Lincoln is surrounded by scores of whites, and Lincoln sees Douglass, and he raises his big, tall arm and says, "Here comes my friend Frederick Douglass. I saw you in the crowd today. What did you think of my inaugural address? There is no man in these United States whose opinion I value more than yours." Douglass said, "Mr. Lincoln, that was a sacred effort." There are other occasions in which Lincoln had invited Douglass to dinner or tea at the soldier's home, but Lincoln had a speaking engagement and refused to turn down the speaking engagement even for the president. It was a point of principle. Lincoln, of course, is assassinated a month later. Had he lived, they almost certainly would have continued their friendship and maintained it. So what do we learn about their friendship? Let me just summarize 3 points. One is that Douglass and Lincoln's friendship was chiefly utilitarian. And that's not to take anything away from it. Douglass understood that he needed Lincoln on his side for him to achieve his chief aim, which is ending slavery and moving toward racial equality. And Lincoln understood that he needed Frederick Douglass on his side in order to achieve his chief aim, which was simply and chiefly preserving the Union, because he understood that Douglass was the ambassador of African Americans, so to speak. And Lincoln, and he said this publicly on numerous occasions, without the aid of blacks, there's no way we can win this war. And so these two discrete aims, preserving the Union, ending slavery, had converged into one, which reflects the social revolution. The two discrete aims had converged. Second lesson, I think, is that Douglass and Lincoln never agreed politically. One's a revolutionary, a prudent revolutionary. The other is a moderate to conservative Republican. And yet they got along, which highlights the degree to which political beliefs do not coincide or do not correlate with interpersonal relationships. Which I think is very important, especially today in this divisive political community, because it highlights the degree to which democracy is not about everybody agreeing the same way. It's a democracy about people having very passionately different beliefs and being able to work together and even define themselves as friends. Douglass and Lincoln's relationship is a great symbol, I think, of democracy. The third theme is in their understanding of self-making. Most people probably understand self-made men or self-made women. Frederick Douglass was the foremost male feminist of his day, so embraced the idea of self-made women. They understood as rising up to get rich, since after the Civil War, that's how most people have understood it. It's not how Douglass and Lincoln understood. In fact, the term was coined by Henry Clay in 1832. And what most Northerners understood by self-making is that as you evolve and as you transform yourself, you also seek to reform your society. One of Douglass's most famous speeches that he gave over 50 times is called Self-Made Men. And he emphasized that the true self-made man is someone who seeks to eradicate the sins of society. As you evolve, you also seek to reform society. And that's something that Lincoln believed too. And that's very different even then from what many, if not most, Southerners believe. You could say that Lincoln's counterpart was Nathan Bedford Forrest. Nathan Bedford Forrest, like Lincoln, was born in a border state in a log cabin, dirt poor, poor white trash. Nathan Bedford Forrest rises up to become a multimillionaire by the eve of the Civil War, becomes a Confederate cavalry general, and then after the war founds the Ku Klux Klan. That's a very different kind of self-making or self-made men. And the other aspect of Douglass and Lincoln's understanding of self-making is that they define themselves as being continually in flux or continually changing. And indeed, who Frederick Douglass was in 1830 was very different than who he was in 35 and 40 and 45 and so on. And both men changed especially dramatically during the Civil War. It's why in 1861, Frederick Douglass could say, and this is basically a quote of Lincoln, he's a representative American racist. And then 3 years later, meet him and call him a friend. Because who they were changes radically and continues to evolve. The self is in a state of flux. And that's crucially important because it explodes the very concept of both slavery and racism. Because slavery, among other things, depends upon this vigorous, rigorous ceiling above which you cannot evolve. It imposes a fixity, so to speak, on people. And racism, among other things, is defined by the belief that one person or group of people are permanently superior to another group, which also implies this fixity. Let me just show you some images that highlight what Douglass and Lincoln or other blacks and whites are up against in being able to forge the kind of interracial friendship and alliance that they did. This is a representative image from, it's actually a weird book. It's Josiah Knott and George Glidden. They were scientists who published a best-selling work of science. Called ethnology, now it's known as anthropology. And in this image encapsulates the central theme of the book. discussing the distinction between a white, black, and a chimpanzee. Here you have a skull of a supposed white man, and then you have a statue of Apollo Belvedere, who's kind of an emblematic representative white man. Now, how you get a skull out of a statue, I'm not sure, but they do. And then you have an African, or a Negro, and a skull, and then you have a chimpanzee and a skull. And if you notice the way, the reason why they include the skull is, notice the verticality from the forehead to the jawline, and the horizontal nature of this skull. Well, these pseudoscientists were trying to argue that the more horizontal the line is from the forehead to the jawline, the less brain capacity you have. It actually still reflects our language today of highbrow and lowbrow. Lowbrow is a greater slant. The basic message of this image, which was the theme of the book, is that blacks are subhuman, more akin to apes than they are to other humans. Hence, slavery or certainly racial oppression is warranted. In virtually every white American, or the vast majority except for abolitionists, when they describe the devil was a black man. This is the painter Charles Diaz from Washington Irving's tale, The Devil and Tom Walker. And the devil is a black man. Nathaniel Hawthorne, when he invokes the devil in his writings, a black man. This is representative. This is from Edward Clay, actually a cousin of Henry Clay, who includes this cartoon called The Fruits of Amalgamation. And it really highlights the fear of most whites about what will happen if you have racial equality. Essentially, most whites can't envision the idea of racial equality. Instead, if you give blacks rights, and you emancipate them, essentially it's going to flip, and it's going to be black over white instead of white over black. And this Fruits of Amalgamation, now the black is the patriarch of this household. He's reading the abolitionist newspaper, The Emancipator. The white man is a servant in the background. There is a painting of Othello and Shakespeare's Othello about an interracial relationship. The black man is playing on racist fears that the black man has married this white woman and they have these grotesque children because it's unnatural for black and white to marry and have offspring together. And on this wall here you have a portrait of William Lloyd Garrison, best known white abolitionist, and then the dog is chewing up Tom Paine's Age of Reason. That's the fruits of what abolitionists will do. The very term miscegenation is coined in 1864 by the Democratic Party. I mean, talk about a race-based election. Democrats are saying, if you re-elect Lincoln, this is what's going to happen. Basically similar to the other slide. Here, Lincoln is meeting, bowing down, and greeting Charles Sumner's, the famous abolitionist from Massachusetts, his black girlfriend. And in the middle, you can't really read the words, here's Frederick Douglass doffing his cap as he rides in a carriage. And this is seen as essentially hell on earth for whites. And this is Richard Cain Woodville, a Baltimore painter, which actually wonderfully encapsulates the prevailing vision of Americans, which is a white man's democracy. Here you have, the slide was cut off, it's called the American Hotel, clearly symbolic. In the portico of it, in the portico of the American Hotel, you have all these different types of whites, you know, top hat, fairly wealthy, town crier, various classes of whites. And outside the body politic, outside the citizenship, are two blacks. Portrayed actually comparatively sympathetically at the time, but they stand outside America, outside the body politic. There's a close-up. And slave owners in the South, in seeking to combat Frederick Douglass and other abolitionists describing the horrors of slavery and the degree to which slavery is based on violence, you know, they send these millions of prints basically describing slaves as being happy. Hey, we treat our slaves just like our children. They are incapable of reaching adulthood, and so we protect them. They're better treated than northern workers. Abolitionists had their own campaign, and this begins in England with Josiah Wedgwood. Wedgwood pottery is still around. Wedgwood hires a printer to make, or an artist to make, Am I Not a Man and a Brother, in which the slave is praying, supplicating to God, because the central theme for Douglas, Garrison, all the abolitionists, it was that in God's eyes, all humans are equal. God is no respecter of persons. Thus, it's incumbent upon us to treat all persons like that on earth. In fact, the feminist movement emerges out of the abolitionist movement, and the slave is supplicating to God. It also reflects a certain paternalism because there's no Jesus or God there, so in, for many white abolitionists, the slave is also supplicating to whites for freedom. And this involves, here it's 1837 broadside, which is like a poster. And here this black man, he has hamstring muscles to die for, face it. Biceps and triceps to die for. I mean, he's clearly capable of rising up on his own. And this continues, persists in the Freedman's Monument in Washington, D.C., which is to commemorate Lincoln on the anniversary of his assassination in 1876, and here's a better slide and a close-up of it. In fact, one of Douglass's great speeches was the unveiling of this Freedman's Monument. He didn't like the monument because he saw it as paternalistic, but this was, it was the first speech that he gave to literally almost the entire heads of state. President Grant unveiled it, the entire Supreme Court that was there, most of Congress was there, literally most of the heads of states was there. And in this speech, Douglass, I think, brilliantly encapsulates Lincoln's virtue, Lincoln's greatness. He begins a speech speaking to mostly whites and saying, you are Lincoln's children. We, me, I am Lincoln's stepchildren. Why? Because Lincoln's never had us blacks as central to his vision. And you can imagine the white crowd, these dignitaries, like shocked. And then he employs what he often does, it's a surprise, a reversal. He says, if you judge him on the abolition ground, he's tardy, dull, worth criticizing, but that's not how we should judge him. Lincoln is a politician first and foremost. He took the oath of office to preserve the Union. He should not have accepted or embraced the abolitionist position because that's not who he was, but his greatness reflects the fact that although his chief aim was to preserve the Union, and we began as his step toward, and he adopted us into the national family. And that is what makes him truly great. And it did. Douglass, here's a representative photograph. It's called a daguerreotype of Douglass. And Douglass, I now know I'm actually doing another book called Picturing Frederick Douglass, the most photographed American in the 19th century. There are more photographs, more separate poses of Frederick Douglass than of Lincoln, than of anyone. So right now the order is Frederick Douglass, George Armstrong Custer, Abraham Lincoln, and Walt Whitman. Douglass sat for his photograph whenever he could. He believed the photography, the truthfulness of photography, was a crucial aid in his reform work. One of the reasons why Douglass was such a brilliant orator is because he was, even his enemies acknowledged he was handsome, majestic in his wrath. And Douglass also had a rich, deep, baritone voice that sounded like music. And he actually, frankly, read the Columbian Orator more carefully than Lincoln did. And so he kept the audience on the edge of his seat. And he always dressed up immaculately like this. Was very disciplined in how he performed because his central goal is in looking like this, and speaking beautifully, and planning his speeches, essentially he wanted to out-citizen white citizens. And he knew that in a sense, he and other free blacks, although they constitute a tiny minority, they're the key to emancipation. Because they will show these whites that we're better citizens than you. Lincoln was, I mean, mostly birth. Lincoln had a high-pitched voice. And the three adjectives that people used to describe Lincoln at the time were ugly, awkward, and grotesque. It's hard to be a brilliant orator if that's how you're seen. And he also would bend his knees. You know, it's really long, big. He'd bend his knees at the wrong time. Journalists would say his speeches, the substance were great, but he looked like a nutcracker. So it's too bad we don't have a recording of Frederick Douglass, because ideally you want to hear Frederick Douglass and you want to read Lincoln. There's Lincoln. In fact, this is the photograph that, according to Harold Holzer, helps get Lincoln elected when he gives his Cooper Union address. New York introduces himself to the East Coast. This is the first suit that Lincoln owned that actually fit him. All the other suits, it came up to about here in his arms. And it's the first photograph in which he actually looks presidential, and it's Matthew Brady, and it's widely disseminated. Here's the second inaugural, and it's a beautiful image. The detail's rich, and I think there's Lincoln giving his second inaugural, and it's really blurry down here, but I think I've identified Douglass, although I still have a little more work to do on that. There's Douglass with Lincoln's cane. After Lincoln dies, Mary Todd Lincoln gives Douglass his cane because she understands their relationship. And here's Mary Todd. Mary Todd loved fashion. In fact, you probably know Elizabeth Keckley, who was the kind of female counterpart to Douglass, because women were not embraced as public speakers. She became one of the preeminent dressmakers. Was a dressmaker for many politicians and made dresses for Mary Todd. And this was an age in which making dresses was truly works of art. And there's Anna Murray, Douglass, and who helped, as I said, help him escape. Unfortunately, Anna Murray never embraced the power of language in the way Douglass did. She remained mostly illiterate for her life, which led them to grow apart. He continually evolved. She remained somewhat the same. And when she dies in 1881, Douglass was very depressed, and he remarries. It wasn't a politically correct marriage because Helen Pitts was his secretary and 20 years younger, but they had a beautiful marriage, and it was Helen who helped ensure that Douglass's home in Anacostia was preserved. And there's Frederick Douglass as an old man. Let me just end by briefly mentioning why I think their legacies are so important. And Douglass and Lincoln, Douglass was a major influence for every African American in the 20th century. To give you a sense of the long period in which Douglass and Lincoln until civil rights occurs, that after Douglass and Lincoln's friendship, the next time that a black man meets with a U.S. president in terms of near equality was when Martin Luther King Jr. meets with Johnson, President Johnson, 9 times in the 1960s. So in a sense, if the Civil War was about the status of blacks, the South wins in preserving a new order of black and freedom. Frederick Douglass, despite his fame, was out of print for most of the 20th century. It's why many, especially people over 50, never had Frederick Douglass in school. He hasn't entered the classroom until recently. Douglass and Lincoln, most recently, the best example of his ongoing influence is President Obama. Regardless of how you think of him politically or where you stand politically, Barack Obama has explicitly acknowledged the influence of both Lincoln and Douglass. Lincoln far more than Douglass, because he understands if he says, "I've been deeply influenced and inspired by Frederick Douglass," his enemies are going to say, "Oh, Douglass was a good friend of John Brown, the terrorist." Bill Ayers, Frederick Douglass, John Brown, you know, that's who you are, the terrorist. But in Audacity of Hope, Obama borrows one of Douglass's speeches and said, "From Frederick Douglass, I learned that in certain circumstances, power will concede nothing without a fight." And like Douglass, he understands the most effective way of fighting power is with words. That's why Douglass doesn't go to Harper's Ferry with John Brown, who spends 2 days trying to convince him. Thinks Brown's going to die. It's a stupid move militarily. But he also understands his greatest asset is with his language. Most of you, for all of you no doubt, know that Barack Obama sees Lincoln as his great hero. In fact, when in 2008, he announces his presidency in Springfield, referring to Lincoln as the self-made man. He takes a train ride to D.C. similar to Lincoln's. He takes the oath of office on the Lincoln's Bible, so to speak. He is himself, and is said to say, one of the self-made men. He's a child of mixed race parents. His father abandons the mother, essentially. He receives fellowships and rises up to become our current president. He also learns a lot from Frederick Douglass, because Douglass, like Lincoln, he sees himself as pragmatic, seeking to try to unite people. Whether you agree with it, that's at least he sees himself that way. But Douglass was crucial for him, because Frederick Douglass, this is a quote from Douglass, who said that true art breaks down racial barriers. Although, as I've emphasized, most whites at the time saw blacks as subhuman. When Douglass goes out on stage and he presents himself as this artist, becomes magical, and people see him no longer as a black man, but as human, who identify, it encourages this kind of empathy. And if you think back to the 2008 election, when Obama first declared his candidacy, regardless of what you think about him politically, no one thought he could get elected, even his closest friends. But to give him 45 minutes to an hour to give us political speech and weave together personal stories with political ideals, and he's one of the great public speakers of the 20th century. And like Douglass, he understands the importance of becoming an artist and breaking down the racism that continues to exist. And in fact, at the 2008 election, many people, many pundits thought that Obama would lose, even though he's ahead of the polls, because of the so-called Bradley effect. In other words, whites saying, I'm going to vote for him, and then they go in the polls and vote for a white man. And there are many instances in 2008 of whites, when interviewed, saying, I'm not going to vote for a black man, I'm not going to vote for a mom. And then they actually see him perform. It's like, whoa, you've convinced me. True art can break down racial barriers. Even if you're a Republican or you hate Obama, even his enemies would acknowledge that, hey, he is a brilliant speaker. It's only words, though. That's how they would explain it. It's only words. Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln have inspired truly hundreds of thousands of people. And hopefully they will continue to inspire us in subsequent generations, that they will inspire us to bind up the nation's wounds, to complete the unfinished work, and to fulfill, finally, the ideals of freedom and equality of opportunity for all Americans. Thank you.
Thank you.
I can repeat the questions. Yeah, go ahead.
I don't think you mentioned any correspondence between Lincoln and Douglass. And back in those days, people did correspond. I mean,
that's a great question. So I did mention the long report that Douglass sent Lincoln about forming essentially special forces to go south to bring men back. But you're absolutely right. So part of the reason why, you know, when I published that piece in 2005 in Time magazine, that's the longest piece that had been published at that time, because there's not this rich body of correspondence. So fortunately, Frederick Douglass had a great memory and wrote down a lot. So he would write down, about his relationships with Lincoln even before he met him. And then I just spent a number of years searching for corroborating evidence of their first two meetings. So that's where I found John Eaton, after their first meeting, was the next person to meet with Lincoln, who describes Lincoln saying to him, you know, I met with Douglass, I consider him the most meritorious man. But that was the real difficulty. So I had Frederick Douglass's writing describes in detail his three meetings, the fact that Lincoln invited him to tea, but I wanted corroborating evidence, so I just spent a lot of time finding other corroborating evidence. But it's also why the book, you know, their friendship, their self-described friendship, in terms of total pages, it's a fairly small amount. And what surprised me and struck me was the degree to which, as I emphasized, this black man and white man led these strikingly parallel lives long before they ever met. But it's a great question. Yes?
How long did Douglass live, and did he keep writing?
Yeah, so Douglass lived until 1895, and after the war, so if he's a radical, he's a prudent revolutionary, radical abolitionist through the war, after the war, he becomes a kind of insider elder statesman, a Republican. He's the first black African-American to hold a federal appointment that requires Senate approval when he's appointed to the to be the head of this, what's it's called, the DC kind of standard bearer where he shows around people. I'm blanking the name for some reason. And then becomes the recorder of deeds in DC, another federal appointment. And he's the first black man to be appointed minister or ambassador to Haiti. After the Civil War, because now the 13th, 14th, 15th Amendment, now the Constitution guarantees equality before the law, he doesn't have to engage in extra-legal action in the way he did in supporting John Brown, not as Raiden Harper's Ferry, but other trying to retrieve slaves from southern communities. But he does, near the end of his life, he champions women's rights. He's a vigorous critic of the culture of lynching that emerges in the South. He's a major influence in helping to pass with other abolitionists the 14th and 15th Amendment, which guarantees citizenship for all Americans and black men, the suffrage. And Douglass, when it was clear that there's no way the 15th Amendment could pass that would give women and men the vote, Douglass said, we got to take what we can get and then just keep fighting. And he did. Really did. But he remained an activist throughout his life. About 6 months before he died, there was a young African-American who made a pilgrimage to his home, and very smart, hardworking, and said, you know, I came to see you because I want some advice about what to do. I'm thinking of, I want to go to school. I'm not sure whether I should become a lawyer or a writer or a business person. Do you have any advice? And Douglass says, agitate, agitate, agitate.
It's my understanding in reading, I believe it's Henry Mayer's book, All on Fire, about William Lloyd Garrison.
Yes.
Talk about another self-made man.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
Who grew up in poverty.
Yes.
Anyway, it was my understanding that he was saying that in the most extreme sector of the slave-owning aristocracy in the South, there were people who were not satisfied with maintaining slavery in the South. They weren't even satisfied with extending it into the territories. They wanted to make the entirety of North America a slave nation.
Yes. Yeah.
I wonder, based on that, if when the Confederate troops went all the way into Pennsylvania, if Lincoln didn't suddenly realize this was an offensive war for them and not a defensive war. And if that's why he went to Gettysburg and said, this is the line, I'm drawing it, you're not going any further, and I'm going to penalize you by doing immediate emancipation in the South. I wonder.
Well, Lincoln's evolution toward the Emancipation Proclamation, toward emancipation, was a lot of it hinged on the border states, as I mentioned. Also, it hinged on his understanding of the constitutionality of ending slavery in rebel states. And in fact, one of the first things happened to Lincoln when he reaches the White House is Charles Sumner runs to the White House. He's actually hobbles because he still hadn't fully recovered from the caning of Preston Brooks. And Sumner's mentor had been John Quincy Adams. And Quincy Adams as early as 1836 and then subsequently thereafter, in his battles with slave owners in Congress seeking to acquire Texas and basically create this empire for slavery, stood up in Congress at one point and said, if you Southerners keep being belligerent, there's going to be a civil war. And you know what? If there's a civil war, the Constitution, under the War Power Clause, gives the President and the Congress the right to end slavery in a state of war. And that's precisely the constitutional basis by which Lincoln and Congress end slavery. But Lincoln felt that there was, and other Republicans felt that there need to be such a crisis that that it was legitimate. But the main reason was the two main reasons were the border states, and Lincoln was very sensitive to the large swath of Democratic Northerners. Now, Marylanders would have probably seceded had he not arrested them and thrown them in jail and prevented a secessionist convention. And in Ohio and in the Midwest, there are a lot of Northerners who were simply outraged at the idea of turning this war into a war for emancipating slaves. Actually the details are that he had written a draft of the Emancipation Proclamation early of 1862, and under the advice of his cabinet, refuses or decides not to issue it because he felt that we need a major military victory to make it palatable to all of these racist Northerners and Democrats in the North. And he knows that there's going to be a major battle, which becomes Antietam. Lee's moved north, and Lincoln enters into a covenant with God. He tells his cabinet. Said, God, if you give us a military victory, I'll take that as a sign that I should issue my Emancipation Proclamation. McClellan declares a tenuous victory, and Lincoln issues it immediately thereafter. It also had followed on the heels, as I said, of the First Confiscation and Second Confiscation Act. And so by this point, there had been precedent of the war being turned into an abolition war. And by 63, when Lincoln says to Douglas, once I make a decision, I won't turn back, he was right. The Gettysburg Address, which I see as one of the great works of secular scripture, I mean, he's clear about the revolutionary nature of this civil war. And by 64, he's starting to embrace the idea of racial equality, of black men voting, which in 60, you know, it's like colonize them. And this is someone who does not like, who's horrified by revolution. That's an extraordinary transformation. Yeah.
I'm just curious, looking beyond the facts of the Confiscation Acts.
Right.
On the ground, as a result of the Confiscation Acts, and the result of particularly the Union Navy and the coastal expeditions
right.
in early 1862,
right.
And the fall of New Orleans
right.
and opening up of the Mississippi,
right.
there were large numbers of slaves who were self-emancipating, in
yes,
effect.
Yes, absolutely.
By reaching Union lines.
That's right.
And so Lincoln was faced, this is my question, how, you know, to some extent was Lincoln faced with also the reality that sooner or later, Emancipation Proclamation or not, he was following, in effect, facts on the ground that he needed to, you know, that there was no way to put it all back to a status quo.
Yeah, so that's a great question. The way it could have been put back in the status quo is that the South won, and the Confederacy comes very close to winning on a number of occasions. So the First Confiscation Act, if you're a slave and you reach Union lines, in practice you're free. But what happens if the South wins? You go back into slavery. And this was, no one knew. In fact, both sides thought the war would only last 3 months or 6 months. The reason why the Congress and then Lincoln uses the language forever free is to say, hey, no matter what happens, this is a legal ruling that these slaves are forever free, because that everything is still hanging in the balance. And so it's a great question, because on the ground, you're right, even after the first Confiscation Act, slaves who reached Union lines, were, they started working from their perspective, they're free. But no one understood what would happen. And it's also why Lincoln wasn't satisfied with the Emancipation Proclamation and pushes for a 13th Amendment, which he argues. But it's also a great point, and it highlights something that Douglass emphasized, and that is, it's one of the other lessons from their friendship, and that is that most white Americans to this day, especially after the Lincoln film, still think that Lincoln freed the slaves. Frederick Douglass called the Emancipation Proclamation one of the great documents in American history. He said, we should celebrate January 1st with July 1st as twin births of liberty. But it's absurd to think that one man could free 4 million, regardless of who he is. Emancipation is a big chain, and the Proclamation is one link. More than anything else, blacks freed themselves by moving to Union lines, by flocking to the North. But Congress was also central. The Army was also central. So the effect of the law, the Second Confiscation Act, the Emancipation Proclamation and 13th Amendment, is to say, we don't know what's going to happen. And that indeed, and the other reason is that the Emancipation Proclamation makes it virtually impossible for England or European countries to recognize the Confederacy, because they prided themselves in abolition, even though they desperately needed Southern cotton. And according to James McPherson and some other recent scholars, had Lincoln not issued the Emancipation Proclamation that symbolically turned it into a moral fight and give it more dissemination, circulation than the Second Confiscation Act, England was very close to recognizing the Confederacy. And had England or France recognized the Confederacy, that's essentially a Confederate victory.
The Reconstruction.
Yes. So during Reconstruction, Douglass fought very hard for the 14th Amendment and for the 15th Amendment. He was frankly, though, shocked and taken aback by the degree to which Southerners dug in their heels and did everything they could to preserve this old order. Felt that, in a sense, in my view and the view of some other scholars, felt that that once the 13th, 14th Amendment, 15th Amendment had passed, that would achieve what was needed, rather than calling for more dramatic action at the time. Later, by 1880, Douglass looked back and said what really was needed was that freedmen and women in the South needed land, and also came to agree with Charles Sumner, who, in my view, even more than Thaddeus Stevens, offered a solution to the problem, the horrors of Reconstruction, that's the closest that could have worked. Sumner and Douglass both understood how important slavery or white supremacy was to Southern whites, to their way of life. And so Sumner's solution was to take, and also both of them understood that the South was controlled by some very powerful elite men. It was a majority. In fact, both of them believed, and we now, according to William Freeling, scholars have affirmed this, that according to William Freeling in his book, had secession been based on popular vote or referendum, Southern states wouldn't have seceded. It's these really 100,000 or a few hundred thousand of these very wealthy white Southerners really controlled the South. Two-thirds of Southerners were non-slave owning. And so Sumner's solution, which Douglass came to agree with, was you take the most powerful white Southerners, and what's the punishment for the crime of treason, which every Republican at the time recognized? It's execution. Well, we spare them execution, but you permanently deport them. So you take the 1,000 or 2,000 or whatever, whoever is in power, and you permanently deport them. And then you give their land to freed men and women. It's not so much ethnic cleansing, but call it regional cleansing. And that way, blacks can forge their own democracy. Congress wasn't about to accept that. Congress was not about to accept that. When Sumner first issued it, he first suggested right after Lincoln was assassinated, so that it got a lot of circulation. But even Northerners were very sensitive to the idea of redistribution of land. In a sense, you could say, and I emphasize this in the course I'm co-teaching on the Civil War from Nat Turner to Birth of a Nation, that the basic debates that were occurring during the Civil War are still with us. It's how our nation is defined. The debates about what's the proper source of authority, federal versus state authority. Should a democracy embrace a welfare state? The beginning of the welfare state is in Reconstruction. Questions about land redistribution. Equivalent of affirmative action. That's straight line from then to now. Questions of sovereignty, state versus federal. I mean, after Obama was elected in 2012, scores of politicians are calling for nullification of Obamacare or outright secession. And of course, the question of the vexed question of equality before the law. It really begins in the Civil War. As we know in the 20th century, the question of a welfare state, whether it's the FDR welfare state or it's the welfare state envisioned by radical Republicans in Congress, a lot of Americans have big problems with that. You know, the Republican Party is energized in response to FDR's welfare state. Regardless of what you think, I mean, that's every scholar of neoconservatism acknowledges that. So that's a long answer to your question, Reconstruction. Yes?
Between September 17th, 1862, and July 1st to 3rd of 1863, mm-hmm. The Union Army or the Army of the Potomac already had conscripted black men in the Army, right, in the Union armies. Who the British politicians, Slidell and another man, mm-hmm. Made a secret deal with Confederate spies, an agency in Canada, mm-hmm. which is just above the border of New Hampshire and Vermont and New York,
right,
that if either the Confederate armies had won Antietam or had won at Gettysburg, is it true that there was a regiment of 11,000 British Royal Marines were ready to invade if the Confederates had won Gettysburg? England would have recognized the start of independence for the Confederacy. Is that true? Did Frederick Douglass know this?
The answer to the second part is no, he didn't know that. There is good evidence that there were a regiment of British supporters of the Confederacy, but the question is whether or not England itself would have recognized that. Because in England, unlike the United States, the vast majority of Brits were huge supporters of abolition. And especially the key difference between England and the United States is that poor workers in England, unlike the poor whites in the United States, they were the greatest champions of abolition. Why? Because for the mill workers who, during the war, I mean, they're starving to death and they're still championing the Northern cause and abolition. Because for them, slavery threatened the very dignity of free labor. It threatened their very identities as working class free laborers in the way that it didn't in the United States. And so it's crucial to understand that abolitionism in Britain is a truly mass movement. And the British government understood that. And they understood that they would have a very difficult time supporting, especially after the Emancipation Proclamation, after the Civil War, is now a war to abolish slavery, British government understood that they would have a very difficult time convincing the mass of their countrymen the way they should do that.
So the Confederacy losing the Battle of Gettysburg, then England withdrew those Marines back to England.
Well, there's also a question on whether or not the Marines were acting on their own accord or whether they were acting under the auspices of the Prime Minister, and that's what's unclear. And there's a debate on that question. That's really how autonomously those British soldiers were acting.
Another question.
Great question.
I've read it in books. I'm an avid reader of Abraham Lincoln since I was 10 years old.
I can tell.
But I ask you this, if you know this. Do you ever know the story of when Abraham Lincoln grew his beard after he was elected in 1860?
Yes.
Because he was clean shaven.
Yes.
Do you know the story?
Yes. Grace Bedell.
9-year-old
little girl writes Lincoln a letter, says you would look so much better with the beard.
It would help other men who grew beards to get married.
Yes, it would help other men to grow beards. It's a 9-year-old girl. She's from upstate New York.
He goes to
Rod Douglas's hometown of Rochester. And Grace Bedell is in the crowd, and Lincoln, they raise her up. And Lincoln essentially thanks her for advising him to grow a beard. And for the rest of his life, he had that beard. It's a great story. I mentioned that in the book. It's a great, great story.
I'm glad you put that there.
Yeah.
In your book there.
Yeah. Other questions? Thank you very much. I'm happy to answer other questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Stauffer. It's really a great book. I'm right in the middle of it, and there's so many great anecdotes in it. I was wondering if you might say something about Mount Misery. And who the current owner is.
Oh, yes. Douglas, you know, so I mentioned Edward Covey, the slave breaker who Douglas had this epic battle with. Covey is another self-made man, Southern style, in that when Douglas was in his employ, Douglas points out, or when he was beating Douglas, he only owned one slave. It was a female slave that he forces to spend the night with one of the male slaves he's renting out in this tiny little shack. Lo and behold, after a year, she's pregnant. Now he owns two slaves. And he continues to expand his slave rental practice. By the eve of the Civil War, in today's dollars, he's a multimillionaire. He acquires, builds a home on the Eastern Shore. Because of Douglas's popularity and the influence of his writings, Covey's home after the Civil War on the Eastern Shore of Maryland becomes known as Mount Misery. And even people on the Eastern Shore today know of Covey's home is Mount Misery because he makes slaves miserable. And in, I can't remember the exact year, I think it's around 2000, Donald Rumsfeld purchased Mount Misery. So I don't usually offer that at talks because I don't know what the political identification my audiences are.